Welcome to How to Make It in the City on WBAI in New York 99.5 FM. This is a show where we explore both the practical and spiritual aspects of making it. This show is for artists, entrepreneurs, dreamers, and visionaries who are determined to end the cycle of working soul-crushing jobs just to pay bills. This is where we learn how to live our mission while making a great living. This is where we learn how to do well by doing good. This is where we learn how to step into our divine calling while entering a space of financial freedom and abundance. I am your host, Ama Karikari-Yawson. In August of 2015, I quit my six-figure salary day job as a corporate lawyer to step into my purpose of healing through storytelling. I now travel the country performing my stories, such as my debut book, Sune's Gift, while facilitating presentations and training sessions for schools, universities, governments, and corporations. Loved ones, it has been quite a bumpy ride, and I have a long way to go. Let's figure out how to make it in this city together. During this session, we are going to learn how to legally form our companies and businesses. Audience members, this is so dear to my heart because, as you know, I am a performance storyteller, and I often do my work for corporations and universities and elementary schools and high schools and so forth with drummers. I have a story to tell you about this. So I hired a drummer one day who I met on the subway. He was really great, very, very talented. I say, hey, I have a gig coming up at the Marymount School. Can you come out? Can you perform with me? He comes, he performs, he's great. I write him a check. Few minutes later, while I'm enjoying my lunch, he comes back to me and says that he can't accept the check. Why? He tried to cash it at Bank of America, and he did not have state-issued ID. He only had his veteran's card. And so he said he couldn't accept it. I would have to leave lunch to go with him to take out cash. Although he was a wonderful performer, I was irritated, annoyed by the situation. And so I was unable to hire him again. I had other people who were more formal, who could accept checks, who could accept PayPal, Venmo, Chase QuickPay, other forms of payment. This happened in 2015. Fast forward some years later, 2017, I bump into him on the subway and he's looking disheveled, looking rough, looking very, very, very hard up for cash. And it occurred to me that I would have given him more work. I would have wanted to put more money in his pocket had he just been more formal in his manner of doing business. Audience members, there are amazing artists, entrepreneurs, visionaries out there who do not have any formal structure for their work. They're unable to accept credit cards. They're unable to accept checks. They are only working in the underground economy. There are benefits and there are disadvantages to this, and this is what we are going to discuss today. So we have a great legal panel here for you. I'm going to introduce two of the guests who are going to help us with this subject. The first is Douglas F. Wasser of Wasser Russ. Now, Douglas is a highly rated business attorney with over 30 years of experience. He represents parties who may be organizing or restructuring businesses, transferring wealth earned over a lifetime to the next generation. They may be engaged in probate and estate litigation, administration, resolving conflicting fine art claims, including disputes as to ownership, authenticity, or provenance, and reclaiming funds taken from businesses by fraud. Additionally, we have David Harrison of Spiro Harrison. David is versatile in all areas of complex litigation, having successfully represented both plaintiffs and defendants in federal and state court at the trial and appellate levels. David also serves as outside general counsel for emerging and middle market companies, providing clients with legal and strategic advice regarding entity formation, employment agreements, commercial contracts and licensing agreements, acquisitions, management of exposure, and protection of intellectual property, among other things. Thanks so much for joining us, Douglas and David. How are you?
Oh, we're doing great today.
Doing well, Ama. Thanks for having us.
Oh, good to have you here. Okay, so let's start getting into this. The many artists and entrepreneurs who are listening, and as I said, as I explained, they do their work in the informal economy. They generally only accept cash, and they have not created any legal entity for their businesses. What would you say are the pros and cons of such arrangements, David?
Thanks, Ama. I would, this is a question that hits close to home for me. At Spiro Harrison, we are a startup law firm. We've been around for about a year and a half, and we're a group of big firm lawyers who came together to start a law firm that was versatile enough to work with startup companies and emerging businesses and entrepreneurs. And so, we understand that one of the biggest issues facing entrepreneurs and young businesses is how to spend their money, where to spend their money, how to get the biggest bang for their buck. And so, I understand working in an informal economy is easy, right? You take cash, you spend cash. You don't have to worry about the procedural hurdles of applying for registrations, working with attorneys or accountants. So I get it. It's quick and it's easy. But I have some big concerns with people who are doing this. The biggest is protection. Businesses that are operating in an informal economy aren't protected. They're not protected from a liability standpoint, so that if they get sued or they have debts, somebody can go after their personal assets, and that's a big concern. If you're starting a new business, you want to be able to protect your personal assets so that any liabilities of the business are isolated from you independently or personally. And the other protection is IP protection, intellectual property. People want to make sure if they're generating revenue from their ideas that those ideas are protected. So that may be technology where you'd get a patent, or it may be some creative work where you'd get copyright protection, or some brand where you'd get trademark protection. But you want to make sure that those ideas are protected. You may have competitors out in the business market, and you don't want them to be able to steal your ideas and to profit from them. And then the other side of it is that if you're in a business that's going to be raising capital, if you're in a business that's going to be trying to attract investors, those investors are going to want to see brand protection. They're going to want to see brand strength. And in order to have brand strength or market strength, you're going to need to be protected. You're going to need your ideas protected so that your ideas and your brand is marketable.
Okay. I absolutely really appreciate that. Doug, would you like to add anything?
Well, thank you, Ama, and thank you for having us, and I thank your listeners for tuning in, and I congratulate your listeners for having the courage to go out into the world and to follow their dreams. David really pretty much did a great job of setting forth what entrepreneurs, starting out entrepreneurs and new entrepreneurs should be doing, forming some sort of entity, creating some sort of entity organization to protect against personal exposure, personal liability. So I endorse to a full extent what he had to say. Even before that, talking about the factual presentation that you said with his drummer,
yeah,
I would encourage all your listeners to create at least some indicia of finance, have a checking account, have a bank account,
yeah,
have a credit card, have a credit history, so that if ever you want to lease space, somebody can look you up and conduct a credit search, and you show up on the radar. And that happens not only on a personal level, but as your business begins to grow, you want to lease space. You want to engage in some sort of contractual arrangements with a third party. That third party is going to want to investigate you to some extent. So you need to have some sort of history out there.
I so appreciate that. So I think that both of you have touched on two issues. One is protection, and the second is growth. Protection meaning that You do not want anyone to be able to go after your personal assets. So you might be running a business from your home. Something may happen in that home. You get sued and you might be in danger of losing your home because there's no formality. There's no veil, so to speak, between your work and your dealings and your actual personal life. And then second, we have this idea of growth that Doug was pointing out. The people want to be able to support you. They want to be able to support your work, but they need a history. And if you have no formality to the business that you have, there's no history, and therefore they will be reluctant to work with you. If me, I'm a Karikari-Yawson, I'm not, you know, huge, I'm not a major corporation, but I'm saying for my business, Miles Tales, my publishing and consulting company, I don't want to work with a drummer who's bothering me on my lunch break to say, hey, you need to take out cash right now because I can't cash a check. If little me, and I'm not saying this to belittle myself, I think I'm a great person, but I'm saying if I am saying I don't want to work with you for that reason, imagine some major corporation or major organization. I pay my drummers in the hundreds. Other organizations can afford to pay them in the thousands, perhaps tens of thousands. They are not going to work with you unless you have some formality, some history. And back to that idea of protection, for all of the wonderful street musicians who are out there and they're performing and they're singing and they're doing this great work, you want proof that the work is your own. You don't want someone stealing this and presenting it as their own. This happens every day of the week. If major corporations sometimes can't protect themselves from forgery and what bootlegging, then how are you in a position to not even make an effort to protect yourself? So I greatly, greatly appreciate all of those responses. Listeners, I hope that you are taking this to heart. So now, if a listener is taking this to heart and saying, hey, Ama has a point, Doug has a point, David has a point, it's time for me to get legit. How exactly are they going to be able to do this? They may start Googling and they may realize that there are so many different ways that they can legally form their companies. They may, you know, be sole proprietorships, general partnerships, corporations, limited liability companies, limited partnerships, limited liability partnerships, nonprofit entities such as 501c3s and 501c4s. I mean, the list is going on. I'm tired just reading some of these. Right? So imagine, and I took corporations in 2007 or 2008 at UPenn Law School. Imagine someone else who's, you know, my drummer, for example. How were they going to figure this out? Doug, can you help us?
All right. So we have, if you're going to go out and your drummer is going to
try to create some sort of entity.
Try to create some sort of revenue stream. He can do it as a sole proprietorship.
Okay.
As we were discussing before, hopefully that drummer has some sort of history that he can establish.
Okay.
Next step up, assuming he begins to generate some revenue. It's either your drummer, it could be a painter, it could be a sculptor, it could be any type of artist, any type of entrepreneur. Go to the next step, and that is to create a separate financial structure, a separate entity that creates, drops kind of an iron curtain between the business aspects that you conduct and your personal assets, and that's a corporate entity. And there are various different types of entity structures, corporations, LLCs. If you're going to be a solo, conduct business as a solo, then you're generally looking at either a corporation or an LLC. An LLC is a limited liability company. Mm-hmm. Limited liability companies are a little bit more expensive to organize, and they're really geared more towards entities that have multiple owners. They're better framed for that. There's some debate as to whether a corporate form of entity is better for you if you're a solo and conducting business as a solo, or whether an LLC is better for you for that. But those are the two basic types of entities. As you should only have these issues. You should only grow in success to the point where your revenue is growing, where you can start looking at more complex structures, 501c3s. Mm-hmm. Those are profit or not-for-profit oriented entities, charities of some sort, foundations of some sort, where perhaps the objective is not solely generating revenue, but serving some sort of public purpose as well. But for the basic part, I think we're talking about the corporate and LLC, limited liability form of organization.
David, would you like to add to that?
Sure. Yeah. Thanks, Ama. What I would say is that if you are an individual or you and a couple of your buddies are starting a business, I think it's one of the most important decisions you'll have to make, and I think it should be the first decision you're going to make is how should you structure your company. And what we tell people is that they should just think about their goals, think about what they want to do, think about where they're going to go and how they're going to grow, think about the future a little bit when they're deciding how to establish the entity. And so, as Doug said, you know, it may depend on, you know, how many people are involved. It may depend on how much you want to grow. But just to give you an example, if you're starting an LLC that you think is going to grow and that you want to use to attract investors, say venture capital firms or angel investors, people that are going to invest in your company, you're going to want to think about starting a corporation. So at some point down the road, you're going to have to convert that LLC into a corporation because corporate structures are more attractive to those types of sophisticated investors because you can have different levels of financing. You can have different levels of ownership interests and equity interests. So you want to, when you're forming a corporation or an LLC or some legal entity, think about what your goals are, and in the context of those goals, figure out what's the best fit for you. The implications are important because there are tax implications. As we said, there's liability implications. There are many complex issues involved in forming an entity, and the consequences of forming the right entity versus the wrong entity can be critical.
Appreciate that. Okay, so let me try to sum this up. So for all of you listening, we are seeing this decision not as a one time, you never get to change. Once you make the decision, you're stuck in that formation forever. It seems from our panel of legal experts that we're seeing this as a continuum. You might say at the beginning, I'm going to keep this easy. I'm going to keep this simple. I am a sole practitioner as a drummer, so I'm going to make this a sole proprietorship. Down the line, you may say, hey, this is growing. I want to have other members. I'm going to form a limited liability company. But then you may grow to another level where you're trying to attract investors, people who you're not friends with, you don't know. They just see the growth potential and the profit potential in your business. And at that point, you may decide to form a corporation. So what they've explained to us is this is not one decision that lasts forever. You may change with the different growth phases of your company. But when you're just beginning, for the most part, a sole proprietorship or LLC would be helpful and would probably meet your needs, and then you might grow to a corporation. The other idea that Doug brought up is also understanding what the purpose of your company or the purpose of your legal form is. So for the most part, many people will be for profit. Many of you are forming companies that are for profit entities. These would be your LLCs and your corporations. Some of you may want to create a not-for-profit entity, such as a 501c3. These are tax-exempt organizations that are tax-exempt because they are serving some sort of social good. Now, there are more restrictions, obviously, because that's a huge benefit, being tax-exempt. You may have to form a board. It may take longer to form it as they're vetting you, but you would have to also figure out what the driving force of your entity is. Anything else you want to add to my summation? Sounds okay. Yes, please.
Ama, that was great. I had one artist client, for example, who over the course of his whole career, he turned out to be rather successful, and selling a lot of pieces over his lifetime, and he was about 60, in his mid-60s, perhaps even early 70s, and at that juncture he decided he looked upon himself as kind of the father of a particular school of art.
Mm.
So what he wanted to do was to use his revenue and use his art, donate his artistic pieces to further that particular school of art,
because
that was a social good that he saw. So he created a foundation for that purpose. So that's kind of an example of what it is that you were suggesting.
It is a great example. It is a great example because at first, how was he formed? Was he just a sole proprietor?
He was a sole proprietor.
And then he formed a foundation in order to advance the school of art that he created.
That's the beginning. That's the beginning and that's the end.
Yeah.
I mean, he had a whole lifetime in between.
Decades in between. Okay. It wasn't day one and day two.
So he went from sole proprietorship. Then he formed his corporation. And I might add, as he formed his corporation during his early years, that there are not only legal issues, as David was saying, there are also tax issues.
Yeah.
There are also accounting issues. So it's easier to track your business expenses, your business revenue, if it's coming in the form of a separate entity.
Yes.
Your accountants would love that if you keep your personal life and your business life completely separate.
Yes.
And apart. And that's also another suggestion is engage accountants. Don't be afraid to engage experts. They are out there. They are willing to help. They want to help you. So and they could provide tremendous service for you and tremendous value for you.
Wonderful, wonderful. Success is a team effort. Okay. I think we've been very convincing. Don't you think? I think that the audience members out there are saying, Ama, David, Doug, where have you been all of my life? It's time for me to get legit. How are they going about it? I'm going to say this. This is a threat to our beloved profession as three lawyers here. LegalZoom and other online services for forming businesses. I would like you to weigh in on how exactly you may say for the easy work, LegalZoom is fine. You may say, no, they suck. Come to my office. I'm not sure what you're going to say, but tell us how that artist or entrepreneur listening is to go about forming this LLC, what have you. How are they going to do it? What tools can they use? Who can they call on?
So, I would say, look, I get it. LegalZoom, third-party websites, third-party providers that can offer you fairly cheap and simple solutions to some of your legal issues are helpful. Some of the websites are very good. There's a lot of good information out there. You know, I find that the biggest problem is that information is not tailored to your business. And so, you know, when you're signing up for a website or you're using a third-party service, they're not looking under the hood. They're not understanding what your business is about. They don't understand what your goals are. And so all of the other issues that come up, so, you know, assuming that you're supposed to be an LLC and you go on to one of these websites and they help you file as an LLC, and that's great. You're set up properly. But there are so many other considerations for a business that come into play. As I said before, IP protection, getting your ideas protected is so important. Raising capital, how do you do it? Who do you talk to? What agreements do you have in place? When you're doing business with clients, what kind of contracts are in place? How are you going to be best protected in those business transactions? Are you bringing on employees? Are you complying with employment laws and securities laws? All of these things are so important and integral to starting a business and running a business. And when you rely on those services, you don't have anybody that's looking under the hood. So look, I mean, we have people all the time who have grave concerns about adding a line item for legal to their budget. It's very concerning, and we get it. But it's like an insurance policy that you don't have to get, right? I mean, you have this website, LegalZoom, that you use to get all of your forms from. But if you find the right attorney and you find the right accountant, those people are going to be invaluable to you as they guide you through the minefield and pitfalls of starting a business.
Okay. Thank you. Would you like to add to that, Doug?
Oh, no. That was great. I mean, LegalZoom can help you form your entity. They're not going to advise you as to what type of entity to form.
Yeah.
They can help you form an entity, but that's just the beginning.
Yeah.
That's just the beginning. LegalZoom will not be there to help you negotiate your first lease of studio space. Mm-hmm. LegalZoom will not be there to help you take down your first corporate loan.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that could be okay as a start, but LegalZoom was not going to be there to advise you as to whether you need to form as a corporation, whether you need to form as an LLC, which state to form in, which, you know, where to form. If you form, if you're creating a legal entity in New York, where to locate your principal office. LegalZoom is not going to help with that.
Okay. So if I get you correctly, you guys are very diplomatic. LegalZoom may be taking some money out of our pockets, but you're diplomatic and you say, it's okay to use them. It is fine. It's cheap. It's efficient. While the two of you are sleeping in bed and, you know, in your homes, LegalZoom is there. The website is functioning. But you're telling our audience members there's a caveat. And that caveat is, this impersonal website does not get to know you, your business, and the particular and specific needs of your business. Moreover, you just tell them what to do. You're not actually getting any tailored advice. Moreover, forming the corporate entity is just the beginning. As an artist and entrepreneur who needs to grow, there are going to be other issues that are going to come up. And wouldn't you like to have advice along the way so you don't make mistakes, critical mistakes, you save yourself time and therefore save yourself money. So when you are ready for a relationship and advice, you need to go to a human being. Is that the case, my friends?
Human beings are always a valuable resource.
Human beings are always a valuable resource.
I would just add to that, that you're right. I mean, The issue is as you grow as well. I mean, if you have these agreements that you've gotten from LegalZoom and you're a business that's growing, you are going to have to change those agreements at some point. Those agreements need to be flexible to fit within the growth of your business and the relationships that you have. And it's going to be more expensive for you down the road to change those agreements than it would be if you had them right in the first place.
Okay. Okay. Sounds very, very good. Sounds very, very good. How can our listeners keep in touch with you? How can they use your services? Please let us know. Doug?
Well, thank you, Ama. You can Google my name, Douglas Wasser.
Spell it for them, please.
D-O-U-G-L-A-S. That's Douglas Wasser, W-A-S-S-E-R. My law firm is Wasser and Russ, and hopefully if you Google me, I pop up on the first page of returns. If you want to shoot an email to me, it's Doug, D-O-U-G, at wassruss.com, W-A-S-S-R-U-S-S, .com.
Say it one more time.
Doug,
please.
At wassruss.com, that's W-A-S-S-R-U-S-S.com.
Great. And David?
So, yeah, my name is David Harrison. I'm at the law firm of Spiro Harrison. That's S-P-I-R-O-H-A-R-R-I-S-O-N. Our website is spiroharrison.com, and my email address is dharrison@spiroharrison.com. I can also be reached by phone at 973-232-4109.
Artists and entrepreneurs, we have really learned a lot today. We are grateful to both David and Doug for sharing their insights with us. It is time for us to get legitimate so that we can grow. I'm going to add another wrench, so to speak, into this. For government contracting, you need to have a formal entity. I just became MWBE certified with the City of New York last week, and that process required that I show them my EIN, which is employee identification number. It required that I show them my corporate formation. It required that I show them purchase orders dating back a year so that they could make sure that I was in business. I hopefully will apply for many government contracts to provide services and books to schools and so forth. And that formalization will be invaluable because I would not be able to avail myself to those opportunities. Many of you listening are veterans. Veterans are subject to certain, I would say they fall into a special needs category in which I don't remember the name of the certification, but they can get certified for veteran-owned businesses, minority businesses, women businesses. Many of you would like to be able to get certified so that you can have certain access to certain contracts. Please do not allow these opportunities to pass you by. Become legitimate. David and Doug are here to help us with that process. Thank you. And now we're going to a musical break. Thanks again, David and Doug.
I can change the world with my own two hands, make a better place with my own two hands, make a kinder place.
Welcome back. You are listening to How to Make It in the City on WBAI Radio 99.5 FM in New York. You just heard the song With My Own Two Hands by Ben Harper. I would now like to introduce you to our next guest, Johanne Civil. Johanne Civil has been an integral part of a business improvement district in Queens as its director of retail and economic development. In October 2014, Ms. Civil created the first ever book reading series in downtown Jamaica, Queens. Ms. Civil has worked with several nonprofit organizations that foster public advocacy, economic development, and cultural enrichment. But she is best known for being the visionary behind the Queens Book Festival. The Queens Book Festival is a grassroots project begun by Queens residents in the fall of 2014. The festival was created to introduce the borough and area residents, especially the children and young adults, to the many facets and genres within the literary world, including new and emerging technologies that revolutionize how the written word is consumed. It is designed to ignite and foster a passion for reading in the children and youth of the borough, while also encouraging literacy. At the same time, the festival will celebrate authors and their literary contributions while connecting these artists to the community at large. Welcome, Joanne. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it is great for you to be here. Okay, confession, my audience members, confession. I know Joanne because I am a proud participant in the Queens Book Festival. I participated in it last year and performed my book, Sune's Gift, for child participants, and it was absolutely phenomenal. She is such a visionary to have created this venue for the Queens community. I had to have her on this show because this show is for visionaries and dreamers. So Joanne, please tell us your journey with respect to coming up with the idea for the Queens Book Festival.
Well, it all started, like you mentioned, I used to work for a business district in Jamaica. And part of my job was economic development. Being the nerd that I am, I figured that a reading series would be a great way to bring people into downtown Jamaica.
I love it.
Of course. From doing research to find authors to bring them into the reading series, I discovered another book festival that's part of the five boroughs. I figured when I came back to Queens, we definitely have something this great, something this big. And I didn't find a book festival in Queens. So I decided, silly girl that I am, that I would go through the process of starting a book festival in Queens. Queens is so diverse. We have so many different cultures, so many different languages. It felt natural to me that we should have a platform where the artists that are coming or that are already into the community, for them to have to exhibit their work, you know. And we started the festival in 2014. Several of us in the community put our energies together to make sure that we created something where everyone would feel welcome. Everyone would have an opportunity to participate.
Okay, we need to get to the nitty-gritty of the steps. Mm-hmm. So you're there, you're saying, okay, other boroughs, which shall remain nameless, have these great book festivals. Queens is lacking. How can we not have one? I want to begin one. And you start, like, how did you reach out to people? How did you get this group of people to come behind you and say, yes, Queens Book Festival, it is?
Well, I think a lot of people tend to forget that Queens already had a literary community.
Okay.
It just so happened that the community was not well known throughout the entirety of the borough. Mm. So what we did is we reached out to everyone that we knew.
Okay. So who were these people? Tell us.
We reached out to all of the reading series that were in Queens.
Were these out of libraries? What were they out of?
No. These are actual people like you and I who have 9-to-5 jobs, who have the passion for literature, mm-hmm. that basically created their own things, their own grassroots organizations.
And how'd you find them? You Googled them? How did you?
No. Actually,
you knew them through the economic?
No. I did is through other authors that I already knew, I reached out and I said, do you know anything of what's going on in Queens? Mm-hmm. Those who knew people reached out to me and they started giving me names of reading series. They started giving me events that were happening. I reached out to the Queens Museum, which has a great event every summer for children. Mm-hmm. Actually, they have several of them, mm-hmm. but they have one specifically geared towards authors. I reached out to the Queens Council on the Arts. They have several great programs for independent artists within the community to do their work. Mm-hmm. I think with the current environment, what a lot of people are missing is that the funding situation is a major aspect of this all. All of us, when we're passionate about things, we don't see beyond, actually we see beyond the financial aspect of it. So we put our own funds into these things. We fund them out of our own pockets. And that's what a lot of these people were doing.
Okay.
They were funding these book reading series, these small author little festivals within the community. And they were not getting as much traffic, as much attention as, you know, we felt as a group that they should.
Yeah.
You have a lot of people who've been working at this for several years, and it's just now that they're starting to get the credit that they should.
The recognition.
Exactly.
Okay. So you tapped into an existing Queens literary community mm-hmm. by asking around all the authors that you knew from creating your reading series, authors that you came across. You would say, okay, who are the people who are organizing reading series? How did you approach them? What did you say? How did you get them together to say, we are the forming committee of the Queens Book Festival or what have you?
It actually didn't really go that way.
Oh, okay. Please tell us. How did it go? Yeah.
What I did is I reached out to people who I knew that worked for the bigger institutions, those who work for the library system.
Yes.
Those who have backgrounds in the literary world that are I basically reached out to authors
mm-hmm.
and those who work for these institutions. That's how we created the beginning of the Queen's Book Festival.
Okay.
We have grown to the fact that we now have people within the publishing industry who work with us and also people who work in the science and arts industry that, mm-hmm. that are working with us now. But in the beginning, it was more of my personal relationships that I tapped into so that we can start. Seeing that when I was a kid in college, I paid more attention to what was going on with the cultural community. So I was able to register the organization myself.
Okay, great.
I was able to file all of our paperwork myself.
Oh, tell us about that. So now you decided, how did you decide what you were going to form as and what exactly was the process?
It was...
You wanted, is it a nonprofit?
Yes.
Okay, you decided this had to be a nonprofit.
Absolutely.
Because...
Well, simple fact is we need funding. It's easier to get funding as a nonprofit than it is to get as a for-profit
Okay, because you didn't want patrons to pay for the festival.
Exactly.
You wanted it to be free.
Exactly.
Oh, that's how. Okay.
I think a lot of people miss that point.
Yes.
We're a nonprofit organization because we want to be a free event for the entire
New
York City community.
Yes.
So if we do not get funding and we don't get sponsors, then it makes
happen?
It difficult for us to have a free event.
Perfect.
So we have to start charging, which is basically what we did this year.
Okay. Well, let's go back to last year. So last year, you decide, and this goes into our conversation from earlier in this show, mm-hmm. she decided, I want this to be registered. First of all, she decided, hey, it's not going to be just my backyard. I invite my friends who are authors and we say this is a festival. She wanted some formal organization for the event. And therefore she decided, okay, in all of the realm of different corporate formations, I'm not choosing to be a LLC. I'm not choosing to be for profit because I want admission to be free to the public. And therefore I'm going to make it a not for profit, which will allow me to have people come for free, but to get funding from grant sources in order to be able to pay the money needed for the tents and the tables and what have you for the show. Okay, so you decide, I want this to be a not-for-profit. What exactly did you do to form the not-for-profit?
We went to the New York City website to register your business entity. We registered the organization. We searched to make sure that no one else had
the name first.
We registered the organization. We decided to go through a fiscal sponsor first.
What does that mean?
Basically, a fiscal sponsor is a vehicle that you utilize to get nonprofit sponsorship in the meantime until you decide or until you're ready to become a nonprofit yourself. So any kind of donation that's made through us through our fiscal sponsor is tax deductible for the organization or entity that donates.
Is your fiscal sponsor an actual organization?
Absolutely. They've been around for several years. They're FJC. They're a great organization to work with.
FJC. Mm-hmm. Okay.
They are related. They're right in the city. They're very accessible. They're easy to work with. We also knew of Fractured Atlas, mm-hmm. but since FJC came so highly recommended to us, we decided to go with them.
Did you have to have some sort of personal relationship first, or did
Absolutely
you just choose
not.
Them?
We called them. We told them what the project was, what we intended on doing, the steps we intended on taking. We went through the application process like any other organization would,
mm-hmm.
and they felt that the project itself and the organization was worth the time and energy, and they accepted our application, and now we have that relationship with them.
Wonderful. Audience members, are you listening? So earlier on in this discussion, we talked about perhaps going through a different, I would say, a different process in which your organization's corporate form did not have to stay static. You might start off as a sole proprietor, then move on to being an LLC. Then when you're seeking venture financing, you need to become a corporation and become a corporation. So it does not have to remain static. We see this in the experience of the Queen's Book Festival. She wanted to be not-for-profit so that she could have a free event to the public. She decided that in order to be a not-for-profit, she wasn't necessarily going to jump to becoming a 501c3 herself. She went through this, what we would call temporary form, which is a nonprofit using a fiscal sponsor. And FJC was the fiscal sponsor, and she registered the company or the not-for-profit with the, you said New York State.
Yes,
New York State.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. Okay, so you go through this process. Now you are officially a not-for-profit fiscal sponsor, FJC. You're able to collect money. How did you collect money? How did you get grants? How did you figure this out?
Well, New York City has a couple of rules that you have to know before you get started.
Okay.
In order to get any kind of funds from your local council member, your assembly member, and so on, you have to be a viable nonprofit for 3 years.
Oh, goodness.
So you have to wait 3 beautiful years and prove yourself so you can get funds to do your
3 years.
Oh,
that's
yeah,
a long time.
3 years.
Okay, hold up. I'm trying to do this counting. You had this idea in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
But I was at the event in 2016.
Yes.
So, sister, how'd you do this?
Well, there are several, actually not several, there are a few businesses within the community who understood what we were trying to
okay.
do. And going through that process, Resorts World was one of the main organizations who stepped up within the Queens community.
Wonderful.
To sponsor the Queens Book Festival.
Oh my goodness. So because you could not get this funding from council members because you had not been around for 3 years, fortunately, there were some we would call responsible corporate funders who saw the vision and came through. So tell us the process. What led you came up with form letters? How were you approaching them?
Well, we did the basics green fundraisers mistakes. We sent okay. out a bunch of emails to organizations
okay.
and basically got nothing back.
Oh, uh-oh.
So we started reaching out to people who knew, who had their own relationships, business relationships within the organizations, and they started guiding us. Like I said, Resorts World stepped up, Charney Construction stepped up.
Did you know someone within Resorts World?
Like,
how
I did
you
not
develop that connection?
I did not.
Or who do you even, is it called the head of corporate giving? Like, who did you
well
Google
there's
to even
several
find
ways
out?
That you can go through this.
Okay.
I'm not an expert
at
I
fundraising.
Can only speak towards my own experience.
Sure.
But the head of marketing is always a great person to know within any organization.
Head of marketing. Okay.
There's also the person who's responsible for community relations. They can guide you towards that. The banks already have systems that are established where you can go to their websites and complete their forms. There's no other way around most of the banks in New York. So you have to go through that process.
Okay.
When it came to local businesses, we just reached out to the local businesses.
Person to person. You just showed up at the local.
Well, we didn't want security to be called on us. So we definitely didn't show up.
Okay.
We did a lot of emailing and a lot
call.
Of calling.
Okay.
Charney Construction, which is a great business in Long Island City that does construction in Long Island City, stepped up. And the day I called, they gave us the funds.
Wow.
Because he understood what we were trying to do.
Goodness.
And he wanted to support
Charney.
Yes.
We thank you. Wonderful.
Absolutely. And what's happening this year is we only have one sponsor.
Okay.
Because we wanted to, with the experience that we had from last year, we wanted to concentrate on making sure that the logistics of the festival was on point.
Yes.
We had so much going on last year. We were so excited. We wanted to show everybody everything.
Yeah, it was so big.
It was so big. So we decided, you know what, this year we're going to downsize so that we can have a better I guess you can say a better marinade of the situation.
Okay.
A closer,
more intimate gathering.
Yes.
In which there are fewer things going on at each time so that people can focus on
on
individual activities.
Exactly.
Okay.
And with that, again, I got to say, to me, Resorts World is a pillar within the Queens community. They stepped up. They became our sponsor for the year.
Wonderful.
A lot of people think that they gave us whopping amount of funding. No, they didn't. They gave us enough so that we could actually just do the event this
yes.
year. We would have loved to have more sponsors on board, but we weren't able to solidify any of those relationships
okay.
this year. So therefore, what we're doing is we're doing, like I said, something more intimate, something that will show the absolute value of the book festival within the community. I think what a lot of people are missing is, as much as we love our authors
yes.
and our writers within the community, the focus of the festival is really reading and literacy.
Okay.
A lot of the children within the community, from when I was working for the business district, I found out that a lot of them are struggling with reading and literacy.
Yes.
You have several other organizations within the community that are doing their best to step up to the plate to provide additional programming for the,
yeah,
for the children.
Support for those students.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But it, if they could get more funding or if other organizations can step up, the room is there for them to do so. So we decided that that was the main focus. What we've done on that aspect is we've attended school events, where, which is how we invited you
yes,
that first
I've
year.
Yes, I've done school events through the Queens Book Festival.
Exactly.
So other authors, you can do so too.
Mm-hmm. So we invite authors to come to our school events to basically read their books.
Yes.
Some of them have donated some of their books.
Yes.
Some of them we've had the opportunity to purchase their books to give at events. And a lot of other bigger publishing houses like Scholastic. Scholastic's mm-hmm. Donated so many books to us last year. We went through the process of giving those books away at events.
Yes.
We also have several comic book companies, which a lot of people, I know they know comic books, but they don't think of it. Comics are a great vehicle to get kids
to learn
read.
How to read. Yes, they
exactly.
love the pictures and the action.
Exactly. So they donated a lot of comic books to us, which we were able, those were the first things off the shelf.
Great.
When the kids saw them, they ran
they
to
were
us
so, excited.
So they can get the comic books. That's how we focus on the reading and literacy aspect of the book festival. We also have other events that we do, like we have an event that we're doing with the Floating Hospital this coming month, where we're giving away hair products to women in homeless shelters, and we're also bringing books for the kids.
Beautiful.
I think a lot of people tend to forget that when we are and I say we as a community, when we are in these situations in life, sometimes little acts of kindness can
go
bring
a
someone
long way.
Exactly.
Okay, so we're understanding this now. You're in Queens. You were seeing that there were some issues with literacy in Queens among our young people. You also believed in economic development for the borough. And so you had this great vision of a book festival which would celebrate Queens authors and promote reading, etc. You were able to come up with this formation, well, not come up with it, but avail yourself to this formation, a not-for-profit using a fiscal sponsor. FJC helped. It's the fiscal sponsor. You registered the company. Then you went through this work of getting sponsors because you were unable to get council member funding because you had not been around for 3 years. And so you actually reached out personally by phone, email to a number of corporations, and the vision was realized. And now for the second year, you're tweaking the vision, you're tweaking the finances in order to make sure that it is intimate and it is sustainable and it is manageable. Phenomenal. Tell us about some of the greatest challenges and greatest rewards throughout this process of coming up with this festival.
Honestly, the only challenge we've had has been funding.
Money. Money, 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 money. That's the greatest challenge. Yeah.
People will give you everything. They'll give you the clothes off their back. But when it comes to getting their money,
tough.
Oh, my goodness.
Tough.
But really, funding has been the biggest challenge we've had because of the simple fact that we were basically a brand new event.
Yeah.
So we had to
no
prove
track record.
Exactly. We had to prove ourselves.
Yes.
And now that we have done so, it's more... It took us 2 years to do one festival.
Yes, yes.
So now we needed to regroup. A lot of the staff that we had, they moved on to other projects.
Yeah.
So we're back to the core nucleus.
Okay.
That's doing everything again.
Oh, wow.
And we wanted to make sure that our authors understood how important they were to
yes.
the process.
Yes.
So we wanted to focus on them to make sure that they had a better experience with us this year.
Okay.
We've done so many things. I think people were kind of shocked seeing that how on point we are this
yeah.
year and getting information out to
yes.
them and getting proper scheduling and everything. So if we had the proper funding, we would definitely have.
Because you'd be able to hire more staff.
Exactly. And have a better experience for the community.
And how has it been rewarding?
Rewarding. Oh, my goodness. Seeing children
light up with books.
Exactly.
Yeah, with the comic books and whatnot.
Exactly.
Because that was your goal, getting children engaged.
Yes. And when you do have the authors in the community reach out and express how happy they were with the event and how they would love to participate the following year, when you have people calling up and saying, I hope I didn't miss the boat. I'm like, those are the kind of things that bring a smile to
our faces. Tell us when this event is so that our audience members can come and support.
This year, we are going to be on Memorial Day weekend. We are a two-day event as of now. We are Saturday, May 27th, which is the Children and Young Adult Day. Mm-hmm. And also we are on May 28th, which is Sunday. So we're Saturday, Sunday at LIC Landing, which is 5230 Center Boulevard in Long Island City. We are going to be there from 11:30 in the morning to 7 o'clock at night. We have children's authors who are reading. We have the best thing that we were looking forward to this year is a Steam Deck, and that's going to be by the Steam Academy of Jamaica. We have several VR experiences for the kids to go through. We have panel discussions with young adult writers and middle grade authors. And on the main day, we have a lot of surprises that are coming forward.
So exciting. We thank you. Now, I have had the pleasure of getting to know Joanne because I've participated in the Queen's Book Festival and hope to do so this year. And I know that one of the many challenges that she had is that sometimes she would introduce herself to people as, you know, the founder, creator, or the vision behind it, and they would be surprised because somehow they didn't expect someone who was, I don't know, as young as her, as black as her, as naturalista and beautiful as she is, to be the person behind it. And I just want to thank you for creating this forum and to say you deserve to be the one who did it because you did it. For all of those decades that our borough did not have the festival, and you stepped up with this vision, worked hard, toiled, did all you had to do to make it happen, you proved yourself to be the chosen one. And I'm so grateful to you and wish all blessings upon you. Thanks for being here with us. Give them the hashtag or Twitter feed, whatever, for so that they keep me. Is it QBF? How are they keeping in touch on Twitter?
We are queensbookfestival.nyc, which is our website. Uh-huh. And on Facebook, we're Queens Book Festival. And on Twitter, we're Queens Book Fest.
Perfect, perfect, perfect. Thank you. This concludes How to Make It in the City. We are grateful for the expertise and experiences of Douglas F. Wasser, David Harrison, and Joanne Civil. They have inspired us to believe that we can indeed make it in this city. Thanks so much for listening. I am your host, Ama Karikari-Yawson, Esquire, author of Sune's Gift and Educator. I'd love to visit your school, corporation, or organization, so please feel free to contact me at ama@milestales.com. milestales.com, or call me at 347-886-2026. Again, 347-886-2026. Please support the uplifting work of this show and this station by going to www.wbai.org and becoming a WBAI buddy. Also, please go on to WBAI.org to listen to our other episodes of How to Make It in the City. You do not have to be up at 4 a.m. We are online at all times. Thanks so much. Until next week, I'm wishing you all love, joy, health, peace, and prosperity. Be well, loved ones.